Welcome to an unconference about students with additional needs in remote learning environments. Produced by Benetech, Bridge Multimedia, and CAST, with support from the U.S. Department of Education, Institute of Education Sciences, and the Office of Special Education Programs. Ideas that work. Module 1, Platforms for Accessible Remote Learning. Opening Welcome by Ed Metz, EDIES, and Sarah Brazel, EDIES. Opening Keynote, Growing Up During COVID-19. Accessible Platforms for Remote Learning, Tips and Practical Advice, Universal Design for Remote Learning, Virtual Gaming, UDL, and Students with Additional Needs. Welcome to Students with Additional Needs in Remote Learning Environments, an unconference, presenting a virtual performance.
If the world only knew what I could do, they would be astounded.
If the world only knew what I could do, they would be surrounded.
If the world only knew what I could do,
get too hard, then I disappear.
I wish I could tell them and make them understand. Being different wasn't something I had planned.
But when people look at me,
but I'm supposed
to be
if they only knew.
Text, Epic Players, a neuro-inclusive theater company. Ladies and gentlemen, let's give a warm unconference welcome to Dr. Edward Metz, EDIES Program Manager, and Dr. Sarah Brazel, EDIES Program Officer, National Center for Special Education Research.
Hello, and welcome to today's virtual education unconference focusing on supporting students with additional needs in remote learning environments. I'm Ed Metz from the Institute of Education Sciences in the U.S. Department of Education, where I lead the Small Business Innovation Research Program, known as SBIR. The program provides funding to entrepreneurial education technology firms to develop research-based products for use in education and special education.
And I am Sarah Brazel, also from the Institute of Education Sciences, where I am a program officer for research and education technology in the National Center for Special Education Research. Our center provides grants for research, development, and evaluation of technologies to support children and youth with or at risk for disabilities. Schools have now been closed for 2 months because of the COVID-19 pandemic. Educators and parents have been adjusting to children being at home and learning remotely. But now we are entering a new phase that includes preparing for summer. For many, this means they will not have access to regular summer activities such as camps. There is also a lot of uncertainty about the return to school in the fall. The goal of today's convening is to provide special education practitioners and parents information, resources, and educational tools to support students with and at risk for disabilities. During the event, we hope to engage in a virtual dialogue with you, to hear your voice and to connect with you. We are all in this together. The day will include presentations and conversations by a range of speakers with expertise across the field of special education, from stakeholder and industry groups to technology developers, researchers, educators, and parents. Many of the speakers today receive grants from programs at the U.S. Department of Education at IES and at the Office of Special Education Programs, as well as other federal programs to develop and evaluate interventions in the area of special education.
The format for today's event will include several types of interactive sessions. There will be a series of lightning talks and panel discussions focusing on remote learning, with expert speakers providing guidance on how to keep presentations on platforms like Zoom, with information for practitioners and parents so that they can leverage new forms of accessible and assistive technologies to support children and students, and with resources on learning games, digital tools, and no-cost summer activities in areas such as math, literacy, and social and emotional learning, designed to be accessible for children and students with a range of disabilities. There will be a keynote speaker to start and end the day presenting innovative remote teaching and learning models for special education. And as you just watched, during today's event, there will be a series of short artistic performances and interviews featuring many talented students. The videos were recorded during the past few weeks with students contributing from remote locations. As Sarah noted, today's virtual event is intended to be interactive. During all of the talks, there will be time for Q&A between you and the speakers. So please be ready to submit your questions via the Q&A feature.
Before we hand off the virtual microphone to our first keynote speaker of the day, we want to thank our colleagues who did such a fantastic job organizing the event, including CAST, Benetech, and Bridge Multimedia. We thank all of today's speakers as well. We also thank our federal partners at the Office of Special Education Programs at the U.S. Department of Education and the Administration for Children and Families at HHS, who you will hear from at the end of the day.
And of course, we thank all teachers and parents at home today. Thank you for your dedication and work and for making such a difference in the lives of our children and students. Today's virtual event is going all day from 11 a.m. to 6 p.m. So stay tuned here or drop back in when you can. And please reach out to Sarah and I if you have questions about the research programs we lead at IES to support educators, families, and students with special needs. Thank you very much.
Yes, thank you so much.
For our opening keynote, we're pleased to introduce children's media consultant, Sarah Chomsky, who will be presenting Growing Up and Bouncing Back, the three R's for the pandemic, review, recalibrate, and recover.
Hi, everyone. I'm Sarah Chomsky. I've been working as a children's researcher for about 15 years, and I do work for a lot of media companies, toy companies, and nonprofits. I like to say that I help to bring the voice of kids and their families into the creative process. Before research, I worked in production and development for educational media at places like Sesame Workshop and Blue's Clues. I'm excited to kick off this unconference today with a talk about child development and how we can help our kids during this challenging time. I vow to keep this presentation upbeat and solution-oriented. We've all heard a ton of bad news in the past few months, but we've also had some success stories. And I'd like to continue that positive momentum. So let's get started. First, why we're here. I'm sure you've heard people talk about the three R's when it comes to education: reading, writing, and arithmetic. I'd like to introduce the revised three R's for dealing with our current situation: review, recalibrate, and recover. I'll go into these in detail, but for now, just know that we're going to get a handle on some of the timeless truths about child development, what's true now and needs to be considered in the time of the pandemic, and what we should be doing next. I'm going to start with a quick overview of child development. We tend to bucket kids' growth into three areas: physical, cognitive, and social emotional. There are typical milestones within each of these buckets that parents and educators key into when they're dealing with kids. These milestones are helpful, but of course we know that every child is different. Every child develops on their own schedule and at their own individual pace. And we also know that these skill sets are interrelated in how they manifest and may also depend on the personality of the child. So a kid who is feeling overly challenged in too many cognitive or physical areas may be affected social-emotionally. They may lose confidence and the urge to try. But another child with a different personality with a lot of physical or cognitive challenges may dig in their heels and try harder. So as people who love and work with kids, we need to keep an eye on which mindset our kids naturally have so that we can help them make progress at their own pace. So let's look at the progression. We all know that for kids with special needs, we can't focus on the exact age that a child is supposed to reach a milestone, but we do want to help them make progress in each area. When it comes to the physical, we want to help them develop gross and fine motor skills and work toward mastery as best they can. And you'll see in this art example, a child getting more and more detailed and even developing a style by the end. Cognitively, we want to help kids taking on tasks that are increasingly complex and nuanced, like absorbing stories that are one layer, like a Blue's Clues, or have subplots, or following characters that are simply good guys or bad guys, versus understanding a more nuanced story with lots of gray areas, like a Harry Potter, where there's a Professor Snape, who could be a good guy or could be a bad guy, depending on the part of the story, and he actually has a little bit of both. Same goes with layering complexities in other subjects like math and science. And socially emotionally, we go from kids having play dates that are set up by their parents to having playmates where they choose their own friends. And at the and eventually posses, where kids are connected by our common interests, like the kids on the soccer team or the other kids in the drama club. We at first see our kids playing side by side, then in small groups, and then finding that group of friends. As kids get more social, they also start to specialize, moving from being more process-oriented to being product-oriented, really caring if what they're doing comes out right or is as expected or as they want it to be. So no presentation about kids is complete without meeting a few cute kids. So here, first is Quentin. He's 12 years old. He's from Brooklyn. He has autism. And like every kid, he has his own development trajectory. Physically, he was quite late in learning to walk. I think he was about 2 when he finally got the hang of it. But now he swims and he ice skates and he rides horses. He just learned to tie his own shoes actually a few weeks ago during the pandemic, during lockdown. His mom was really proud. And his dad. Cognitively, he's a good reader. Plus, he's teaching himself ASL, which you can see in that middle photo. And he has an unbelievably strong memory. Socially, he doesn't converse much. He does a lot of scripting, repeating back things he's heard from YouTube videos or TV shows or movies. But he does have close relationships with his teachers and his classmates, and he recently just, according to his mom, finally made a best friend, which is developmentally appropriate. And this is new for him and exciting for him and exciting for his family. He's a perfect example of how a kid can develop in very nuanced ways at their own pace. What's really happening when kids develop physically, cognitively, and socially, emotionally, is that kids are developing their identity. To figure out who they are and who they want to be, they're constantly exploring. They're trying new things. Maybe they want to play an instrument or try soccer. In trying these things, they learn what they enjoy and what they're good at. And then they put these aspects of their identity out into the world to express them. And sometimes they do this in person. And for other kids, they do it maybe through social media. They get feedback on these aspects of their identity, and they decide what they want to keep. Maybe they get positive feedback and they're like, yeah, I am a musician. I'm good at this. I love this. Or I'm not so good at sports. Maybe I'll try the school play instead. And this explore-express cycle is continuous, even through adulthood, but it's very, very intense during childhood. Feedback from parents and teachers is always important throughout a child's life. But as kids enter school and become more peer-oriented, feedback from peers also increases in weight. Now, our job in all of this is to allow our kids the space to experience this process without too heavy a hand. We can encourage exploration. We can expose them to things, provide opportunities for them to discover interests and passions. And we can provide our feedback. And we can also help them understand and navigate the feedback that they may get from outsiders, which sometimes can be supportive and sometimes cannot always be expressed in the most productive way. Let's move into recalibrate. We reviewed the timeless truths about child development. Now it's time to rethink. Clearly, there's a lot going on right now that's different from normal. We're all very stressed out about very real things. Kids are not blind to this. They feel it. They see it. Every possible routine has been disrupted, from work to school to grocery shopping to leisure time and our hobbies. And even though we still have the internet, our day-to-day world has become very small, almost entirely inside our homes. So our expectations have changed. We've already done a lot of this recalibrating. We're all in survival mode right now. We're likely worried less about things like grades and deadlines, and we're thinking a lot more about physical health and social emotional well-being. The pandemic has brought the social benefits of school and work into really sharp focus, and we're stressed out because the physical closeness that we crave also puts our health in danger. We also need to recalibrate because children's behaviors have changed. We're seeing kids try to process what's going on in their own way, like Tomas, who's in the photo on the left. He's bringing social distancing into his pretend play. He's building buildings out of Lego that have to be closed because of the virus. He's also, and you can see this in the photo, creating parades in honor of what's going on right now, where he's separating all of his vehicle toys and his action figures in a socially distanced way. For some kids, they're also regressing during this time. Now that their parents are home all the time, and maybe this has something to do with the stress they're feeling from these uncertain times from their parents. Lila, who's five, is asking for extra cuddling time from her parents. She's also using a ton of baby talk, and she's even started pretending to breastfeed in some of her pretend play. Social emotionally, we need to recalibrate because new worries have emerged among kids. To unpack this a bit, let's go back to what we know about comprehension. When trauma or disruption happens, preschoolers will only understand the basics. And that's why all they really need to know are the basics here. Many preschoolers are actually happy to be home with their parents more. And when they ask questions, they tend to be very, very simple, like why we have to wash our hands so much or why we can't go visit grandma today. Bigger kids, as you'll see in the quotes on the right, are trying to better understand the uncertainty and the sadness that's going on. While some of them may be exploring these kinds of themes in movies and books, it's a totally different story when it's happening in their real life. Their concerns range from routine things like losing their baseball season to bigger things like worrying about their pets, worrying about their grandparents, even finding out, is the virus near us? Are we in danger? For teens, the stress is, of course, even more intense, since they typically have a better sense of what's going on in the greater world, and they don't yet have the emotional maturity that adults have, typically, for dealing with all of this. That said, for some kids with learning differences, there is a silver lining. Being at home has been beneficial to them. They've discovered new ways of learning that work better for them. Here's a quote from a teen who struggles with anxiety and has autism. And the child explains that the 2 to 3 hours of remote learning that they're doing now is actually much less stressful than the 8 hours in school because there aren't a lot of disruptions from other kids and the stress of having people around them all day, which is a difficult thing for this particular child to deal with. So what's really happening here again? Now during this pandemic, well, the identity development cycle is happening differently, just like everything else in the world right now. The identity development cycle is being disrupted for many children who need experiences that are in person or outside the home in order to explore their interests. And it's being especially disrupted for kids who don't have access to technology and the internet. That said, other kids are reveling in the extra time they may have to explore things or dig more deeply into passions. Changes in their schedule or lifestyle are opening up windows for this kind of thing. But for all kids, this cycle is happening in a more physically isolated way, which is affecting how they can express themselves. They're getting less feedback. They can share to Google Classroom or post something online, but that natural, less formal interaction with people that happens when you're talking to someone at school or hanging out at a birthday party or getting your hair cut, that's gone for the time being. So, last step, recover. This all sounds very dire, but I do want to deliver the important message of calmness. That's the only way we can get through this, and also taking action so we can feel like we're not just getting through it, but we're actually making some progress and helping. So first, step one, take stock of where you are, which is the review. Think about all those aspects of physical, cognitive, and social emotional development. Where is this child, regardless of what's typical? Is the child process-oriented or product-oriented? What complexity of material are they ready for? Do they need happy endings? Or are they ready for a bigger dose of reality with endings in stories or that are more ambiguous or even sad? Are they on track in some areas? Which areas are more challenging? Are they having trouble exploring or expressing? What's their personality like? How are they approaching all of these new routines and challenges? What aspects of learning from home are actually an improvement for this child? And which may require you to change your expectations or develop a new approach? Then step two, once you know where your student is at, you can start to take positive action. First, recalibrate. Know that even if you've already changed your expectations, you may have to do it again and again. As parents and teachers of students with special needs, you've probably gotten pretty good at this already. So this is really just a reminder. Obviously, no regrets are necessary. Whatever you've done is excellent. We all know how important it is to pat ourselves on the back for the hard work that we do. As part of this recalibration, consider the importance of routine. For some kids, you may discover that a more relaxed schedule is something that helps them thrive. They can sleep late, maybe. They can tackle challenging assignments when they're ready for it mentally, in the right mindset. For other kids, routine is essential. So even if the routine is different now, you still must have some kind of routine. Also, know that when this is over, kids who thrive on routine will consider the time we're in now to be their current routine. So when we switch back to going to brick and mortar schools, we're obviously going to have to do that transition again for them and ease them back in. I know already some schools and teachers with special needs students are thinking ahead about how they want to do this transition. Next, find the right time to begin your recovery. For each development area, seek out lessons and material that speak to the current level and needs of your student. You want the challenges to feel just right. Embrace the nuance in different levels for different development areas and different subjects. And of course, reach out to your communities for your best ideas and advice. And finally, remember that wherever your child is in terms of developmental milestones and identity development, every child can benefit from the ongoing explore-express cycle. I know this is more challenging while we're all distancing, but if you're going to carve out any extra time to lean in with your child or student, helping with their exploration and self-expression could be among the more important things that you do for them. What can you try that's new? What can you dig into more deeply that they're already into? How can they show what they know and love, and get meaningful feedback from you and others, and find a cohort of people who share their interests? And that's it. Thank you so much for the opportunity to speak today. If you have further questions, the conference directors can let you know where to direct them. You can also find me on LinkedIn. And I hope that the Unconference gives you the inspiration and the tools that you need for your students and your kids during this remote learning period. And I wish you all the very best.
Join our student remote rock star, sixth grader Sammy Woodcock from Sacco Middle School, Maine, for Sammy's birthday, life skills, and a surprise. Text, Homeschooling 2020. Now, hand on her heart, Sammy recites the Pledge of Allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag, first days of the ocean, sending big waves, and a motion,
like how a single word can make a heart.
Now, Sammy uses a laptop computer.
All right, Sammy's turn. So, Sammy, if you're going to clean your room, what do you do first?
A vacuum.
A photo shows Sammy painting a birdhouse. Now she's back at the computer. The screen displays the words first, then, and last.
Then
I put my life back together.
Okay, what do you do next?
Where do I put it?
Okay, you tell your parents
it's
the last thing you do.
Good job.
So what was the first thing that you did?
I clean my room, back in my room, then I put my room together, and it's my parents. Still got
a lot of fight left in me. Now, using coins, Sammy studies math with her father. Now Sammy paints a large sign. Now Sammy pedals a tricycle secured to the floor. Now she looks out her window at a police car.
This is Jose from CLAST. I work on all sorts of things related to Universal Design for Learning, and I'm going to be your moderator for this first group. We're calling this panel Platforms for Accessible Remote Learning. Before we start, a few things to remember. Keep your microphone muted. Please do that so that we can all hear. As we go through the presentations, if you have questions for the question and answer period, put them in the Q&A box, not in the chat box. That'll help all of us stay focused and hope it'll keep us, make sure that we get to your questions. There is live captioning. And so if you don't see it already, click on the closed caption button and you should be able to see it along the bottom of your screen. All right, so here's what we're gonna do. First of all, you're gonna hear from Rachel Sessler-Twinkowski of the University of Massachusetts in Boston. She's gonna open some eyes and some ears about distance learning and accessibility using all the things that are out there right now, like Zoom, Google, and Teams. Next, you are gonna hear from my awesome CAS colleague, Bill Wilmot, who will talk about universal design for learning in remote settings. And then finally, from the great state of Florida, we're gonna have Trey Vasquez and Matt Marino show us how we can take some of that attention that kids apply to games and use just a little bit of that for learning. After the presentation, we're going to go to our Q&A session. And If you have a question that is really for a specific presenter, please note that in the Q&A box. We're going to do our best to get through all the questions, but the time is short. So if we don't have time, just follow up directly with the presenters later. So here we go. Lightnings about distance learning and accessibility.
Our first track is titled Platforms for Accessible Remote Learning. Please welcome Dr. Rachel Sessler-Trinkowski, CRC CADIS, with UMass Boston School for Global Inclusion and Social Development. Dr. Trinkowski will present accessibility tips and practical advice.
Welcome, everyone, and thank you for joining us for this webinar on remote instruction and services. My name is Dr. Rachel Sessler-Trinkowski. Teaching online and through remote training has been a passion of mine for many years. Now, many of you are facing no other alternative other than to either stop working or adapt to teaching virtually. People will need to stay connected now more than ever. Remote instruction and services can help make this happen. The key is planning ahead to ensure that not only the platform is accessible, but that all of the digital content is also accessible and universally designed. There are many advantages to teaching remotely for students, teachers, and other professionals. My hope is that whether you have no experience or years of experience teaching virtually, that your main takeaway from this session is that this method of teaching can be positive and beneficial for professionals and students of all ages who are blind or low vision. I know that many of you are scared and concerned about switching to teaching virtually. I'm looking forward to discussing your questions and concerns. AFB will also be sharing a list of links with many resources with additional information. We'll get through this together. Let's discuss some overall advantages for remote instruction. First, it eliminates or reduces the need for travel. Remote training also allows for flexibility anytime, anywhere in instruction. Using remote software, the instructor can demonstrate skills or take over to adjust more complex settings on a device. I've actually used remote training software while in the same room with students many times so that we don't have to play musical chairs if I need to assist with settings or to demonstrate a skill before they're ready to perform it themselves. I'd like to discuss some common applications for remote instruction. The first is e-learning using online learning environments such as Blackboard, Canvas, Google Classroom, or other learning management systems. It's important to not only ensure that the platform itself is accessible, but any digital content is also accessible. Another application for remote instruction can include keyboarding to learn how to touch type. And two applications that can be used through the cloud are Typing Club, as well as Typeio through Accessibyte, which is currently available for free. Another application for remote instruction can include assistive technology instruction for screen magnification software, screen reading software, smart devices and apps, accessible optical character recognition, OCR software, or other devices, standalone devices, Braille technologies, and much more. The list is really endless. Now let's talk about how else remote instruction and services can be applied. First, we can apply these techniques in independent living skills and other areas of the expanded core curriculum, such as learning Braille, cooking, cleaning, and other skills to learn how to be independent in a home or other environments. Adjustment to blindness, case management, and counseling services. Another area is support for participants to transition to e-learning and working from home. Many people will need to learn additional tools and software that they haven't needed to use in the past so that they could continue to work from their home environments. And also simply staying connected to the outside world. Now let's discuss some audio and video conference software options. Many are free from device to device. There are fees for some tools and more advanced use with more than two participants. The computer may be heard through options such as Skype, Zoom, and Google Hangouts Meet. Screen sharing is also possible with some tools, including Skype, Zoom, and Google Hangouts Meet. When phone connectivity is limited, these options allow another option for voice and video chat. There are many other options such as FaceTime, social media messengers, and many others. Most are compatible across a variety of operating systems. Additionally, I want to mention the importance of cloud-based software and collaboration tools. Don't forget some tools that could be helpful not only for remote instruction, but also collaboration with other professionals, including G Suite, Docs, Drive, Slides, etc., OneDrive, Dropbox, iCloud, and there are many others. I'd like to recap some of the text, audio, or video chat options. There are many options for audio and video chat, including Zoom, Hangouts Meet, FaceTime, Skype, social media messengers, and many others. Many of you have already likely used some of these tools. Accessibility and compatibility with AT software is critical. There are many other remote software tools that I'd like to mention, including Chrome Remote Desktop. There's a link here for that tool. This is free. NVDA Remote Access Add-on, which is another free tool that can be added to non-visual desktop access, NVDA. TeamViewer is another tool, and I have two links for TeamViewer. One is on using TeamViewer to screen share on a BrailleNote Touch Plus if you have any students or participants using that device. There's also a link for information on BombGar, another on ConnectWise Control, which was formerly Screen Connect. Another option is Remote Desktop Connection, which is the built-in Windows feature. If anyone uses Linux, there's a link for information on Linux Remote Desktop, and also an article from GoToMeeting for options for working remotely. And there's additionally a link to an article from PC Magazine on the best remote access software. And keep in mind that those may not be accessible, but you may want to explore other options. There's many options available for remote control and video conferencing. I also want to briefly mention computing technology setup. It's critical that equipment is set up properly and configured for compatibility with AT prior to any training. This is true for both remote training and face-to-face training. The setup can be done remotely. For those who are new or less tech-savvy users, recruit help when needed. You can view a Chrome OS computer from Android that is linked to the same Google account. You can also take control of a Chrome computer. It's also possible to connect to Mac, Chrome, or Windows operating systems within the Chrome browser. This is also available for iOS and Android. I want to thank everyone for joining us. I'm really amazed by and continue to be in awe of how our community is dealing with this crisis. I'm incredibly grateful for the incredible outpouring from manufacturers and professionals in our field who've offered support and free services during this pandemic. Please don't forget to explore all the resources that we've shared through afb.org/virtualafblc. And you'll find links to help you get started with using a number of video conferencing tools and learning management systems. And there's resources for professionals, parents, and students, as well as information on free technical support resources. Use those technical support resources as you need them. Thank you and goodbye.
Now, one of our remote rock stars, Alice Wright from Montgomery County Public Schools, Maryland, presenting UDL and Remote Math Instruction.
As an assistive technology specialist, as well as a special education teacher, one of my roles during this time was to figure out how we can design our instruction so all our students would have access and work with our teachers to design their instruction to meet this need. And we worked with both general education teachers, special education teachers, and our central office staff to come up with some key features that all our instructional modules should have. They embraced the idea of universal design for learning. They thought about all our students, especially our students that use assistive technology tools to access instruction, and changed the way they designed their instruction. They used tools that they weren't used to before, so they had to learn those tools during this time, as well as teach those same tools to our students. And some of the tools that they learned how to use was Microsoft OneNote, where they were able to put in those lessons that the student needed all in one place, which can help our students with executive functioning skills. Plus, OneNote also has Immersive Reader already built in. We use tools like Canvas for our students, and Immersive Reader is there. Plus, we had the Google Read and Write toolbar where the students were able to listen to their work, and then also use the tools available on that to be able to respond to their writing. And they used Equasio as well, which was a totally brand new product for them. And Equasio is a tool that allows them to annotate mathematics in an accessible way. I'm really very proud of our math teachers, both special education and general education teachers, in rising to the occasion of learning how to teach in this medium of online learning.
The next presentation in our Platforms for Accessible Remote Learning track is titled Universal Design for Learning and Remote Learning. Please welcome Bill Wilmot, MED, Implementation Specialist for CAST.
How do we engage all learners when we're not in the room? Universal Design for Learning, or UDL, is a lens for looking at all aspects of a learning experience, curriculum, instruction, and environment, to make learning goals clear, anticipate barriers, and design flexible pathways to goals that minimize those barriers. How can we use UDL to support successful remote learning for all?
Hello, my name is Bill Wilmot. I'm an implementation specialist at CAST, a nonprofit research, design, and professional learning organization, and the originator of the UDL framework. In my past lives, I've been a middle school math and science teacher and a school leader at arts integrated and inclusive schools. Let's start with a 3-minute version of a 2-day introduction to UDL, and then think about how this can support teachers and students in remote learning. There are two core ideas in UDL that are more evident than ever during remote learning. Learner variability is the norm. Every brain is as unique as a fingerprint. When we as teachers walk into a classroom of 30 students, we have 30 different learners in front of us. Most teachers know this to be true based on their experience, and fMRI scans of the brain in action are confirming it. A second core concept is more of a shift in thinking. Rather than focusing on learners' assets and deficits, what they can and can't do, UDL calls us to identify barriers in the environment of learning. The barriers are in the learning environment, not the learner.
Wait, that's a big shift. UDL thinking really grows out of the world of universal design. The idea in architecture and other areas of design that we design from the beginning for the greatest degree of variability rather than retrofitting.
In learning, if variability is the norm and the barriers in the environment, then it is our responsibility as educators to make learning accessible for all. This means that we have to shift from thinking of a one-size-fits-all model to a flexible model that embraces, supports, and designs for the variability of all learners. How do we do it? UDL guides us to think through this process in an organized way. First, identify a clear, relevant, rigorous goal. This sounds easier than perhaps it is. You have to really think about what you care about most. Are you assessing a skill or content? If a skill, then make the content flexible. If content, then offer multiple supported ways to demonstrate that content. You can always integrate skills and content later. Once we have identified a clear, rigorous goal, next we anticipate those barriers in the learning environment. This is where design gets interesting and fun. If you've heard of UDL before, you've likely seen these colorful UDL guidelines.
The UDL guidelines are an ongoing iterative effort to summarize research from cognitive psychology, neuroscience, and the learning sciences about variability of learners in a concrete and usable way. The big takeaways: learners vary in how they engage with learning, in the ways they take in and organize information, and the ways they act on and express what they know. The guidelines call for designing flexibility into the learning environment to support these dimensions of variability. So when we work to anticipate barriers in the learning environment, we can consider barriers to engagement, representation, and action and expression.
Final step, design options using the same UDL guidelines to minimize those barriers. If the lack of relevance is the barrier, we could couch our genetics course in a context that has more meaning. Perhaps a project on researching genetic history of a family or studying professions in genetics that rely on the content they are learning. That's multiple means of engagement. If text complexity is a barrier to learning the intricate details of genetics, then we might offer audio versions of the texts or accompanying videos or glossaries for students to use as needed. That's multiple means of representation. If the barrier is that the end of unit exam is the only way for learners to show what they know, then we might design content requirements into projects, giving them flexible ways to demonstrate that knowledge. That's multiple means of action and expression.
Okay, that's the 3-minute version of UDL. Now, let's take what we know and apply it to remote learning immediately. where to start?
As always, from a UDL perspective, let's start with the goal. In essence, we have three options when considering learning for the rest of the year. The three R's. We can reduce, take away learning goals that we had planned to pursue. We can replicate if what we had planned to do in the classroom easily translates to remote learning. Or we can redesign if what we had planned would not work in a remote learning environment.
So our first step in remote learning is reducing, identifying the goals that really matter. What do we really want learners to accomplish between now and the end of the year? Next, as we're deciding whether to replicate or redesign, identify barriers to guide your thinking.
So what are some of the barriers embedded in remote learning? Well, I, the teacher, am not in the room with them every day. They're not in the room with each other every day. Zoom is exhausting. Tech takes a while to figure out. Not everyone has tech at home. There are distractions at home. The curriculum may not seem as relevant. Family priorities may not be on remote learning. There's background knowledge needed, distraction from peers, so many different pieces of learning to organize. Okay, so there are lots of barriers in remote learning. What to do about them? Let's look at just one. I, the teacher, am not present. This is a big one and has implications for all three UDL principles: engaging learners, representing and organizing information, and acting on what you know. So let's explore a few options that could minimize those barriers. I'm really just sharing the great ideas of the teachers that I've worked with. If I were there, I could get them interested. Instead, I need to be very clear on what the goal is and why, both for students and for parents. I can use Flipgrid, a video sharing tool for everything from personal reflection to giving personal feedback to learners to creating a joke-telling stage. I can host open office hours, flexible times to check in or just work together, brought to us by Zoom, Google Meet, Remind app, collaborative Google Docs. If I were there, I could just answer their questions. Instead, I can share content in a variety of forms: email, Google Classroom, video, digital books, audiobooks, books in the mail, phone, Zoom. Check out Bookshare and the National Center for Accessible Educational Materials for more options. I can guide learner thinking with how-to or FAQ videos that walk students through a concept, a process, directions for a project, or even how to navigate online resources. Check out Screencastify, Screencast-O-Matic, or QuickTime to record your screen. If I were there, I could help organize. Instead, I'm providing flexible support for students and parents to manage their own schedules. I have created a stuck station with content and organizational resources and a help button that allows students to reach out anytime. So we don't have time to go through all of the barriers that we identified, but you get a taste for how the UDL framework can support an organized approach to making learning more accessible and more focused on developing learning expertise. But wait, let's look at that list of barriers again. Except for the first three, these were all present before remote learning and will be when we get back into our classrooms. To me, that means that there are probably solutions that we've developed during remote learning that will still be relevant during face-to-face learning. Indeed, maybe the line between the two is not so bright as it seemed before. Maybe the two-minute math resource videos that we made for learners can be available in the classroom. Maybe the options for ways to show what they know can stay in place. And clearly sharing our goals and the purpose behind them while being flexible on how learners meet them can endure. Thank you for joining to learn a little bit about UDL and remote learning. Happy designing. For links, more resources, and to reach out to CAST to learn more about UDL, see the accompanying document for this lightning talk. Stay well.
One of our remote rock stars, assistive technology specialist, Dr. Hilary Goldthwaite-Foles of RSU 21 Maine, presenting Let's Keep Learning Relevant with UDL.
As our district has started the use of Universal Design for Learning through implementation this year, our distance learning transition has really tested that. Using the UDL guidelines has helped in our distance learning plans, and it's helped empower our teachers and students to have our content and curriculum and our materials accessible and engaging. and we're not even aware we're doing it, but we're doing it with a universally designed approach. When there are specific assistive technology requests, we're able to use a mixture of low, mid, and high-tech support to meet the needs of our learners. Whether it's telepresence, or email, video, audio, or a mix of all of these modalities, we are striving to continue to have learning be relevant, meaningful, and engaging. Another thing our department continues to do during distance learning is to hold IEP meetings. These meetings may be shorter, but they are super impactful. In my experience as an IEP meeting administrator, the connection between parent and educator teams has been stronger than ever before. Parents are really getting to see what their child is like as a learner, how they learn, and what they need in order to be successful, even in the most challenging of circumstances. This variability and flexibility is needed here, regardless of environment, and I hope that it will continue as we move into the next era of education. Thank you.
Our platform for accessible remote learning track continues with Dr. Matt Marino, Associate Professor with the University of Central Florida, and Dr. Trey Vasquez, BCBAD, Professor with the University of Central Florida. They'll be talking about infusing UDL in virtual environments.
Hi, and welcome to Infusing Universal Design for Learning in Virtual Environments. My name is Trey Vasquez, and we also have
Matt Marino. So I'm going to start out by talking a little bit about where students struggle, and this really stems from some work that Trey and I conducted with the National Science Foundation back in 2015. We began a study examining the efficacy of a coaching program for post-secondary students who had learning disabilities and other disabilities such as attention deficit hyperactivity disorder and autism spectrum disorders. And what we found was that the students at the post-secondary level who were struggling the most had a primary area of deficit around executive function. Now, this dovetails with the CAST guidelines quite nicely. So if you look at the CAST guidelines as presented here, this is the second iteration of the guidelines. And you keep in mind that you have three principal areas that are interpreted from top to bottom, and then horizontally from left to right. You look over at the bottom right, you'll see that executive functions are supported through a number of guidelines under the action and expression principle.
So what do we want to do in order to infuse UDL instruction as part of the learning process, and especially when we develop video games? First and foremost, we have to establish clear outcomes and goals for each of our learning environments. We want to anticipate learner variability, and so it's important for us to consider what sort of accommodations we need to place within these environments to help make them as accessible as possible. In addition to those things regarding accessibility, we also want to make sure that we're measuring outcomes that are aligned to standards that we are really importantly focused on. For example, the next generation science standards or the mathematics standards. We also want to make sure that the instructional experience is fun, and we try to make sure that we get a lot of feedback from students or our target population as much as possible in order to ensure that the environment is engaging and also fun to play with. And then finally, we want to make sure that we have new understanding that could potentially generalize not just from the game environment, but also into real life environments.
So there were really 10 outcomes from our research working with post-secondary students. And they told us that the things that were most important to them were these 10 items. A few of them jumped out at us and were quite surprising. So for example, one of the things that they felt they benefited the most from was a growth mindset. Our coaches used growth mindset strategies with them in order to promote their thinking. So they would go from thinking, I can't do this, to what do I need to do to accomplish this goal? Another piece of this that was particularly interesting was that they were interested in the cognitive reframing, so helping them to rethink the way they were thinking about the process. So when they're working with complex content, they needed to reframe their thinking so that they thought about it from a very logistic perspective, moving from the larger concept to the smaller concepts. And they also wanted humor. So they felt when their coaches were joking with them and having fun, then that was what was most beneficial. That takes us to the gaming aspect. When we designed these games for students with varied abilities, we start with a game design document. And from that game design document, we create a detailed map showing what in the game relates to what UDL checkpoint, and then we give a description of that. So this is an example from a game that I co-developed with Filament Games called You Make Me Sick. And in this game, your objective is to make a host whose name is Pudge as sick as possible by customizing a bacteria or viral strain. Now we provide multiple options for students by giving them, students who have limited background knowledge can choose from a virus that's already in existence, such as rabies. Whereas students who have advanced knowledge can actually go into the pathogen design studio and develop their own bacteria, for example, a spirochete bacteria.
So what does that look like in a game environment? So this is a snapshot of one of the games Matt and I helped create with Language Express. And the goal is to provide players with a day in the life experience of a STEM career job. So this is obviously geared towards transition students. And what we have here in this user interface are some of the accommodations and some of the tools that we put in place, such as a career mentor at the bottom of the screen here to provide feedback on performance. We also have closed captioning, voice to text, et cetera. If you go down to the settings in the upper right-hand corner, you can actually customize what those settings would be per student, and that would allow you to have individualized experiences for each of these environments, and they will carry over across different virtual platforms in terms of the gameplay itself. So what do students tell us? Students have reported to us, and we have a data set of over 5,000 students, and where they are particularly much more interested in playing simulations and virtual serious games to learn about science and mathematics and other STEM content area because it's more fun. They like the ability to collaborate across within the game and across classroom conversations. They actually said that they would rather play video games and simulations than take traditional paper-based tests. Now, this is a critical piece because one of the things that we've seen in our prior research is that we will have a student who goes through the video game and can demonstrate all of the critical components of a particular task and content knowledge. But then when they transfer back to a paper-based test to take the same content knowledge test, they fail to demonstrate the same level of knowledge. So somewhere there's a disconnect between the virtual environment and the traditional paper-based tests that are not sensitive enough to pick those up. And that's where some of the future research that Matt and I are really interested in.
And what this gameplay allows us to do is transfer what's happening on the student's screen and the objectives that they're either achieving or not achieving and transmit that to the teachers so that they can provide detailed with feedback with the students immediately following gameplay or during gameplay. The teachers told us that when they were using the games in their classrooms, they actually led to unanticipated discussions, which we were thrilled about because it shows that the students were engaged with the content and they'd often jump up and say, "Hey, look what I found here," to their colleagues sitting next to them. We also include in the game a number of instructional supports. But what was particularly interesting is this expert modeling tool that we've included, where if the student is struggling, a virtual mentor will pop up and provide them with suggestions about how they may want to progress in the game. We also provide them with immediate corrective feedback so that we don't have them promulgating these misconceptions, which can often happen in middle school and high school. The final piece we wanted to discuss was that the games actually address challenges with traditional assessment. So As many people know, the state assessments that we had scheduled for this year for most of our students were canceled. And as a result, we need another means to assess their knowledge. So game-based learning allows us to connect students' performance in the game to specific standards that they're accomplishing in the game-based learning environment. Now, teachers told us that games and assessment were actually more appropriate because they would have students in their classes who were scoring low on the paper and pencil test. And if you think about this, it just makes sense. You have a student who's a middle school student working with cellular organelles, and they have mitochondria, endoplasmic reticulum, etc. Very difficult for students with dyslexia. In the game-based environment, it simplifies that and allows you to understand what the students know about the function of those cell organelles.
Last slide before we have to close for the day. Here are some of the current challenges and future research directions that Matt and I are headed towards. And with that, we want to say thank you, and we will take questions through the unconference system.
Thank you.
Welcome one of our remote rock stars, special educator Jen LaRochelle of RSU 21 Maine, who is here to talk about flexible remote learning communication.
I will say the one thing that has been wonderful during this distance learning period is the universal design during all of this. You know, it's giving kids an opportunity to print off a worksheet if they need the tangible hands-on piece. I have been told a lot of parents also need that part as well. But also just giving them a chance to voice their thoughts either through a recording and putting it up on Seesaw or adding to a Flipgrid and being able to communicate with their friends and their teachers that way. It's given them an opportunity to really be heard, whereas sometimes during the regular school year with here's a pen and a pencil, here's I want you to raise your hand and have this class discussion, it's giving them the opportunity to test their skills and knowledge in a more comfortable setting. So I've really found that part during distance learning to be successful. It's really opened up opportunities for my kids and parents and families to really get together and work together and do things together and find out kind of what their interests are. I think sometimes in the world that we live in, it can be very fast paced. And you have a calendar on your refrigerator with kid A needs to be here at the same time kid B needs to be picked up and kid C has, you know, one thing. It's really given my parents an opportunity to slow down, and I have heard wonderful things from parents being appreciative of the time that they have to really be able to look at what their kids are learning and kind of compare how they were taught to how the kids are taught now. So overall, distance learning has definitely been something that is not easy, but something I really have enjoyed during this time.
Platforms for Accessible Remote Learning Q&A session with Dr. Rachel Sessler-Trinkowski, UMass Boston, Mr. Bill Wilmot, CAST, Dr. Matt Marino, University of Central Florida, and Dr. Trey Vasquez, University of Central Florida. Our moderator is Dr. Jose Blackerby, CAST.
Hello, everyone. Well, thank you, Rachel. Thank you, Bill. Thank you, Trey. Thank you, Matt. Those presentations were great. We have about 13 minutes to have an open discussion and a question and answer period. This first one is directed to you, Rachel, I believe. It's from an anonymous attendee that says, now that more students will be accessing educational learnings from home, what are some strategies for working with parents to support their children?
So I think it will really depend. I think you have to be flexible with many parents are working. So I think understanding that parents right now may be working while their students, you know, their children are at home taking classes at the same time. So I think that's an important factor. There may be a need for more asynchronous options versus synchronous live options. So you may need to look at, you know, different solutions to meet those needs.
Great. So we have a question from Amber, and I think this is directed to Matt and Trey. Amber asks, what technical support did instructors have to gamify their courses? They mentioned a company, I think. It seems like this is a great tool, but potentially expensive to create.
We were really fortunate to have funding from Ed Metz, who started this show for us today. Back in 2008, we received our first award to develop a series of games and curriculum materials through the Filament Games company. And then another company that Trey and I have been working with recently is called the Social Express, and they have products related to social and emotional development.
And we, in terms
do not
of
know how much those cost.
Yeah, in terms of those two companies, those all incur some sort of cost. However, we do have some products that we've helped develop with PBS Kids, which are rooted in the Next Generation Science Standards. Now, they're geared towards early childhood and elementary school, but Hero Elementary is actually available at the end of this month. It's a brand new set of series coming out focused on NGSS and their new programming. So that's free and freely available.
And we have one more to mention. We just started a project called Model Me. It's about conceptual understanding of mathematics. And it's a curriculum designed for tier two mathematics classrooms. And so that will be freely available starting next year as we'll be testing.
So here's a question from Sita. And I think actually this would apply maybe to all of you. And the question is, how do you implement and assist small groups during remote learning sessions?
I'll go ahead and start. So I think there you have flexibility of different tools. I teach both online at university, and I also teach at a Lighthouse for the Blind. So if you're teaching one-on-one, there's tools that you could use for just one-on-one, whether you need face-to-face communication or audio. But you could also set up group training. Some of the remote control technologies, if you're doing any technology instruction, can be used where you could actually connect to multiple computers at the same time. So that's an option. But also, you know, Zoom, Hangouts Meet, which both platforms are fully accessible. Hangouts Meet does have a built-in automated captioning feature, but keep in mind that it is automated. So there are some limitations to that compared to a live captioner. So there's many different options for having that. And I think it's important to have options for students at whatever age, whether it's children or adults, where they are interacting with each other. So I think the more group activities, the better right now.
One of the things that we've been using at the post-secondary level a lot is we have a larger class. We use the breakout room feature of Zoom, and that allows us to assign smaller groups in a given specific task that they need to complete as a team. So that's just another thing to buttress what Rachel is saying.
Thank you.
Yeah, just to add one thing to that, one kind of possible use of those tools is a kind of drop-in office hours. So even if students, you're just there present while they're working, they can consult you as needed, has been a strategy that I've seen be very successful for teachers, especially of younger kids. And then the other possibility is thinking about how to provide some of the scaffolds that you would provide for small group work in the classroom in a remote learning environment and allow them to connect with each other to collaborate. That depends on the age level, of course, but there's a lot of guidance in scaffolding like group roles and specific outcomes and clarity around how they're going to be assessed that's necessary to make that really successful without a teacher there.
Here's a question from an anonymous attendee, Bill, and I think I'm going to turn this to you. What are some ideas for helping faculty create accessible instructional materials, lectures, handouts, LMS pages, and PDFs?
Well, I would send you first to the National Accessible Educational Materials, National Center on Accessible Educational Materials. That's housed at CAST. There's a lot of guidance there. The other thing I would say, and this is linked in the resource doc that I put, as is the AIM Center, is just understanding the accessibility features that are built into so many of the software platforms that we're using. Just about every software platform that you're using has accessibility features built in, and they get deeper almost every day. So to me, that's a big one, is just understanding those. And you could spend a lifetime trying to keep up with that.
If I could add one thing to that, you know, I think it's important to understand that the teachers, again, with K through 12 or higher ed, they're content experts, and they're not necessarily as comfortable with technology alone, let alone accessibility. So if they need supports, it's important to make sure that they get those supports, whether it's through the school system or third party. I have a list of resources that I've compiled for companies that do remediation or work with people to either do trainings or assist with remediation of individual documents. So that's on our Lighthouse page. It's lighthousepalmbeaches.org, and there's an accessibility resource list.
Rachel, I'm going to turn this one to you. This is from Daryl. What about fields that need context, such as orientation and mobility? How can we make those fields more available?
That's tough. I know there's many mobility instructors who are working on that question. I am not a mobility instructor, but there is one of the resources in the presentation handout that I did with AFB. It's in that resource list. It's either in the PowerPoint or the separate webpage that it's a link. Some O&M specialists have come together, and they have built a very long list of resources. There's, of course, some things that can be done safely, but that safety factor must be taken into consideration.
Thank you. So here's a question from Jay, JVE, and I think this probably could go to all three of you, but special attention to Trey and Matt and Bill. How do you use UDL for students who do not engage with video games and non-human engagement? There was a lot of recommendation for other platforms that are available, but not for more significant disabilities.
So if you have a visual impairment, which I do, it can be very challenging in a game environment. So what we try to do is reduce the amount of information on the screen as much as possible for those students who need it, right? So you would dial back to the essential core game element. And then we offer alternatives through keyboard accessibility, because some students can't use a mouse, right? So we use switches as well.
So Objective Ed is one company. There's many, but Objective Ed has developed a number of games specifically for students with vision loss. And they, you could look up their website. Also, if you go to audiogames.net, they're not necessarily educational, but there's lists of games. There's many games that are accessible for people with vision loss, whether it be apps or software on different computing devices.
Mary Ann asks, I think this will be a good one for you, Rachel. What is the best platform for sharing videos with groups? Currently, I am having difficulty with the sound of videos in Google Meetup with groups of 40 or more.
Zoom is definitely one of my favorites. Zoom and Hangout Meet, it really depends on what you're doing. What I find with the different platforms is you have to make sure that you're enabling the audio and video. And I think some people are not as comfortable with the tech at the beginning to do that. And that's where people tend to run into issues. What I have found is if you just turn the computer off, turn it back on, that often will fix some of the issues. Sometimes you do have to go into sound settings to address that. But Hangouts Meet or Zoom are my two favorites. And they are both accessible, fully keyboard accessible on both platforms.
Thank you. All right, this is from Lauren. And again, I think this is something that all of you could weigh in on. How can we reduce cognitive load, the demands of digitalization, challenges of instruction, technical challenges of instructors, towards incorporating and valuing UDL guidelines into higher education in a range of subject areas? So cognitive load is the question.
To me, that always starts with being very clear about what your goal is right now and thinking about multiple ways of getting to that goal. In a higher ed context, you're going to have a lot of assumed background knowledge and finding ways to support that background knowledge. That's true, starting probably in fourth grade and even earlier. But in the way instruction is traditionally designed, we support that background knowledge less and less. But having kind of on-demand as needed resources for background knowledge is a huge piece of that. And some of those can be built into digital textbooks and that kind of thing.
I would also add to that, having your notes prepared for the students so that the students don't have to sit in class and write extensively for an hour and a half. If you have your notes ahead of time online, then the students can have that and refer to it and ask questions and pay attention to the lecture.
One of the things that I saw on the questions was also asking about those accommodations within the platforms of LMSs. Frequently, you can use something like Google Slides and put it in presenter mode, and it'll automatically caption things for you. So if you pre-record your materials, that offers a level of support for those students as well.
You know, often people think they're going to take that face-to-face class and they're going to put it online and it will look exactly the same, and that doesn't work. So you have to consider, you know, the time of someone sitting in front of a device staring at a screen, and you probably want to break up lessons and consider having more things available asynchronously where it students can access it anytime, anywhere, versus having everything live like you may do in a face-to-face classroom. One of the links I have available in my resource list is from the Online Learning Consortium. They have put it out there, and they have some great guides for transitioning from face-to-face to online platforms.
So, and just to add one thing to what Rachel just said, a lot of those things are just as relevant in face-to-face classes where sustaining for an hour or a two-hour lecture is hard for some of us.
So, unfortunately, we have run up against our time allotment, but I want to thank all of the panelists for the video and for the Q&A. I want to thank the people who posed questions, and I want to thank all of the attendees, and please enjoy the rest of the conference. We'll be watching along with you.
Watch these other special education unconference modules. Module 2, Personalized Parent-Child Supports. Module 3, Curriculum Supports. Module 4, Math During COVID-19. Module 5, Adapting for Disabilities. Module 6, Research Updates. Module 7, Reaching Complex Students Through Collaboration on Distance Education. Module 8, EdTech Vendors Forum. Module 9, Closing Keynote, Richard Ellenson, What Have We Learned About Learning? Closing Comments, Tara Corshane, EDOSEP, and Kristen Kane, HHS.